going to introduce Ms. Malalai Joya today. I just want to say a few words in terms of just laying the context for her. Well, it's a good occasion because she's coming to talk about, I guess, the process and experience of writing a book and maybe some of the contents of a book, but also just her whole political symbolism that she's basically symbolizes now because of her resistance to the occupation and also the people who have come back to power who are basically responsible for it, the catastrophe and the tragedy that Afghanistan is in today. So Malalai Joya, for those of you who might not be too aware of her history, what happened in 2002 when Afghanistan was having a Loya Jirga, which is, you know, our Grand Council, she, as her, I think she was in her late teens, when she asked for permission. And she was, I think, there all day, and she was just, you know, basically harping, and finally Mujaddidi, the guy who was the head of the council, said, give this young lady some time to talk. And, you know, they didn't know what was coming, and there was a, you know, not a left but a right hook that she gave them in terms of her, the sternness of her critique, and she basically said that this whole Loya Jirga is a sham. And we know that the seeds that were sown there, we see the fruits today. And all the people who've come back to power, we see that the whole process was a sham and a farce. And she was so perceptive in her points back then in 2002, and maybe people thought of her just some, you know, excited young girl. But you can see that her points had a lot of insight. And to this day, we see the catastrophe in Afghanistan. Just a few points, if I could just say. You know, Afghanistan is a country of about 28 million or whatever, but 70% of the population is less than 30 years old. 30 years old, 70%. And out of that 70%, we have an unemployment rate of 50%. Now, these figures themselves are figures of catastrophe. You know, in America, we had the Great Depression, and it's always a sort of a bleak national memory for Americans because they had a 25% unemployment rate. Today, and you know, the country was becoming radicalized. You see the same thing in Germany when you had the Great Depression. You know, so my point being is that a lot of the problems we see today in Afghanistan is the mismanagement of the money and the corrupt people who have come to power, the NGOs that don't get the money. And what's important is that Malalai Joya brings all that and ties all that together. And that's what's so important about her. And I'm very happy that she finally wrote a book because I can't wait to read it myself. We made a coordination mistake. We thought she's going to bring the books, and we were supposed to get the books. Unfortunately, we don't have her book today, but there is one copy of it, if I may just show you, just in case. So it'll be good to read because it's a book that talks about her own life, but also the situation in Afghanistan. So with that, I'll give the mic to Malalai Joya. Thank you very much. Okay.
Yeah, good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank our friends from Afghanistan Peace Association who organized this event and gave me this opportunity to talk about the ongoing disaster in my crying country and also about the realities of the so-called war on terror by US and NATO. But before I start my speech, let me ask, I could make a speech in English or Persian? Because I know him, my Afghan as well. English? Okay. Before to talk about ongoing tragedy in my crying country, let me to say a few words about this book. As our brother mentioned, the name of this book. After 2003, that I became famous for Democrat people around the world, also they know about me. When I attended conferences, some Democrat writers asked me to write a book on my life, and I didn't agree with them. I told them, I introduced for you some Democrat activists that nobody know them, men, women, also some orphans, widows that we have, that for me important to write about their life story. But they said, no, you should write through your life story about them as well, especially on behalf of war generation of my country. And finally, I got the decision that I trusted one of our supporters. I can say he's a friend as well, honest friend. His name is Mr. Dara Kukafi, who is here right now. And I was... I will be pleased to say a few words about him, that especially I thank him on behalf of my people for his countless hours that he dedicated for this book and wrote that. And he's a very strong activist, and he belongs to a party, Democrat Party. I think the name of your party is stopwar.ca, isn't it?
Organization.
Yeah, this organization, yeah, sorry. So they are strong supporters of Afghan as well, and you should go to their websites and see their activities. And regarding this book, that let me tell you the reasons why I accept to write this book. First, tell the truth, as the first casualty in war country like Afghanistan is the truth. Still, they are betraying the truth. And the second reason, that to tear the mask of these wanted criminals who are brought in creed of the Taliban, and after 9/11 tragedy, they imposed on my people with suit and tie and talking about democracy, these values, but don't believe, and they come in power. And still, they are deceiving people around the world. And the third reason, as a tip of the iceberg, the sorrows and pain of my people reflect in this book, while I believe that books is not enough to write about the deep tragedy of my country. And hopefully this book will help to open the eyes and mind of democratic-minded people around the world. First of all, will bring international solidarity, which is very important for people of my country, for the future of my country. And as you will read some memories in this book, and I tried my best through my life story to tell about the proudful history of my country, about the hero and heroine of my country, about the war generation who are the main victims, and about the condition of the women who are the main and first victims, and still they are the most victims, and about, again, occupation, that they occupied my country, and few other examples that in this book hopefully will help that to know better about the history of my country, because mainstream media always try to give a kind of view to Democrat people around the world. There is women, they, for example, with burqa, and first time we brought women rights in Afghanistan, which is a big lie, and later I should say at least few examples, and also that they want to give a kind of view that there's Talib and these warlords, these terrorist people themselves support them, etc. And Democrats are weak, and they have no Democrat, and many propaganda like this, and all of them for sure I can say is big lies. And let me start my speech about the condition of the woman first. As after 9/11, they occupied my country under banner of women rights, human rights, and democracy. As I said earlier, they brought in power these photocopy of Taliban. That's why today situation of Afghanistan goes to a disaster. Itself is like disaster, especially for the women of my country. In most of provinces, situation is like hell. Only a few examples is enough to know better about the catastrophic situation of the woman. For example, recently these fundamentalists, they made a kind of Shia law against Shia's women. While Shia and Sunni, most of women of my country, they even do not have human life, especially in faraway provinces. And they are making legal their crimes through by making such disgusting laws. And this law, when has been made, despite national and international condemnation, yet it has been passed. And Karzai, this shameless puppet man who do compromise with these criminals, with these misogynist terrorists, he also signed this law. And one article of this law is enough to know how much they are mentally similar like Taliban. As always, we say they are brought in creed of the Taliban. And day by day, they themselves steer their mosque as well. For example, one article is that they ban women to go to the doctor or to have job without permission of their husband, which is elementary rights of the woman. And also rape cases, these domestic violences, and also that acid attacks and killing of women, kidnapping, etc., increasing rapidly. Even I can say it is historical. But when you compare with the period of Taliban, the only difference is that all of these crimes is happening under the name of democracy. They betray democracy, women rights, human rights. and still, unfortunately, they are in power. And also that on 8th of March, you Democrat people around the world, this day you celebrate with lots of hopes and happiness, and at least you exchange your experience with each other. But in my country, on that day, three women set themselves on fire. And which is media give report, and every man tens of women commit suicide, and many example like this. Few days before I come from Afghanistan, that five-year-old girl, her name is Fazila, she has been kidnapped and brutally has been killed, and she by 40-year-old man, because there is no justice. Killing of women is like killing of bird. 14-year-old Bashira was a young girl from Serpil province. She has been kidnapped and gang raped. One of them, son of the member of the parliament, his name is Haji Pinder, one of the killer commander of a wanted criminal like Dostum. And he changed the age of her son less than 18 by documents that do not be punished. How we should stop these violences in Afghanistan, and they have high posts. Many Haji Pinder, many Dostum, they are in the parliament, they have high posts today in Afghanistan while they are wanted criminals. Some small fishes, hopefully do not be insult to the fish, let me make understand well. For example, a small fish is going to the jail for some crimes that they do, but the sharks is free. And they are paying money while they looted millions of dollars. Then tomorrow they are free and enjoying their life and doing same crime, repeating same crimes. Anyway, situation of women is disaster as it was and catastrophic as under the domination of Taliban. And Democrat activist woman who has been killed, that they are risking their life, still they are underground activists, like Zakia Zaki and Parwan has been killed, Sitara Chukzai in Kandahar, Malalai Kakar in Kandahar, Nadia and Jiman in Herat, and this list can be prolonged, activist woman has been killed. When they get killed, only media briefly gave the name of them to the people around the world, while we need these kind of women, activist women, for the future of our country. But nobody guaranteed their life. Some Democrat party, we have still their underground activists, but more than parties, we have intellectuals, men and women, high educated people, but there is no honor job for these Democrats. And that's why situation goes toward disaster. In this 8 years, they changed my country to the center of track. Only this point is enough to know about the wrong policy of the US government and its allies, means NATO, because they are supporting the drug traffickers, these drug lords, and also these warlords, these criminals. And right now, 93% of opium produced from Afghanistan in the world, maybe you got this report from UN, at least gave, and also brother of Hamid Karzai, Ahmad Wali Karzai himself is a famous drug trafficker. Even people call him in his province in Kandahar, Small Bush. And also that Dawood is another person high-ranking post have regarding so-called struggling against opium. He'd like to make rabbit to have the responsible of carrot. Is it possible? And also they are saying to the poor farmers in the provinces, stop planting of opium. But the governors, chief district of these provinces are famous drug traffickers. Four persons who have high post in Karzai's regime, they are famous drug traffickers. And they never expose their name and make them powerless. Through dirty business of opium, every year $500 million goes into the pocket of Taliban that they used for terrorist activities, this money. And since 2001 until now, 4,500% opium increased. And many examples like this, that they changed my country to the capital of opium. This was the first gift of US government and NATO for my people. And I'm sure that if US government do not stop planting of opium, the opium will find its way on the streets of New York as well, and will destroy the youth's of life here as well, the youth's life. This was the main agenda, main policy of them, that because millions of dollars through dirty business of opium, these US government and its allies are receiving, and they are busy still with this dirty business. And also that regarding poverty in my country, that regarding official figures, $36 billion the government received this 8 years. $36 billion is not less. If Democrat was in power, two times Afghanistan was rebuilt instead of one. But most of these monies went into pocket of warlords, drug lords, NGO lords, looters, and these donors themselves. FAO gave report 18 million people of Afghanistan, they live on less $2 a day. Two mothers of my country in Herat and Ghor, one of them 9 months baby, another 5 months baby, because cannot feed them, ready to sell them for only $10. And many shocking example like this, never they want to give these news through mainstream media to the people around the world. And now they want to give more money and more, they want to surge more troops in Afghanistan, which is not good policy, quite the similar policy of Bush administration in Afghanistan. And also, that let me give you the report of recently by UNDP, I think. UNDP gave this report. Let me see where, sorry. Anyway, the report is that from 181 countries in the world, Afghanistan got, Dara, could you help me this report because of my poor English, that when I told you about UNDP report?
That,
it
was 181.
Yeah, this report. Now it become, it become like open secret now for the people around the world that they are looting still the money. Anyway, as long as they are in power, there's no hope to come positive changes in the life of the men and women of my country. And also now my people, they are squashed between two powerful enemies from the sky occupation forces, bombing, killing innocent civilians, most of them women and children. And in the ground, Taliban and also these warlords. But to know better about the role of the troops in Afghanistan, let me give you a few examples. Maybe you also hear through media what they did in Farah province in the west of Afghanistan on May this year, that 150 civilians has been killed, most of them women and children. And even they use white phosphorus and cluster bomb. And on 9th of December, recently, they did bombing Kunduz province that more than 200 innocent civilians has been killed. Again, most of them women and children. Even they are bombing our wedding parties in Ningarhar, in Nuristan. Maybe you hear recently another wedding party that 6 people has been killed. And in Jalalabad, 47 people, including the groom and bride civilian, has been killed. After all of these war crime, White House says, apologize. And Karzai's puppet regime, this mafia system says, thank you. No, my people that much fed up that they don't want to listen anymore, thank you, and apologize. They need the end of the so-called war on terror, which is war on innocent civilians. And still they continue. And when Obama took office, unfortunately his first news for Afghan people was more conflict, more war. As his foreign policy regarding my country is quite similar Bush administration policy, I can say it's just war crime. They are bombing, as I said, they are killing civilians. And right now, not only he want to surge more troops in Afghanistan, he want to decorate barbaric Talib like Mullah Omar and a fascist man like Gulbuddin Hekmatyar, who his name was in the blacklist of UN as a wanted criminal, to join the government, to bring these criminals also in power to make the complete of the circle of warlordism, drug lordism, terrorism to be complete. And also that right now what Obama is doing in border area of Pakistan with this drone attack. First of all, war that will start in Pakistan. It will have main negative impact in Afghanistan that more terrorists will take shelter in Afghanistan. Anyway, I think you also agree with our people that democracy never comes by barrel of gun, by cluster bomb, by war. And at least situation of Afghanistan and Iraq proved this claim. And they must end this tragic drama of so-called war on terror. So in such disastrous situation, the so-called free election were held. You heard about it. Still, they are busy with this tragic drama. This is just ridiculous drama. Put salt on the injured heart of my people. While I think you also agree with us, election under the shadow of gang, warlordism, drug lordism, awful corruption and occupation forces has no legitimacy at all. As a famous saying, it's not important who is voting, it's important who is counting. That's our problem. Except one person, Dr. Ramazan Bashardoz, most of these candidates was discredited and known faces. Some of them even was minister of Hamid Karzai. Hamid Karzai himself is enough in this 8 years to know about him, what he did in Afghanistan. just made powerful these warlords, changed my country to the safe haven for terrorism. And again he's running, and again betraying my people. He chose two criminals as a vice president, like Qasim Fahim and Karim Khalili. Both of them accused as war criminal. Even Hamid Karzai, Human Rights Watch said that Hamid Karzai insulted the people of Afghanistan by this act. Despite national and international condemnation, he didn't change the mind. And other wanted criminals like Muhakkik, like Dostum, even he came from Turkey in Afghanistan to vote for his master. And also Ismail Khan, Sayyaf, these wanted criminals, they did campaign for him, and now this criminal two-part. One part, they like Rabbani, Kanuni, I don't know, this criminal man, Atta, Mahmoud, they, Fahim right now supporting Karzai. They do campaign for Abdullah, who is the main candidate of these warlords, with suit and tie and talking very beautiful about democracy, women rights, but do not believe. They are responsible for civil war in Afghanistan from 92 to 96. And because of power, sometimes they are fighting against each other and exposing their crimes. It's good for not only for my people know them, for the world it is good. And now fighting because of power between two persons that they betrayed a lot my people, Karzai and Abdullah, that do not be deceived by this so-called free election. This is just the most ridiculous election, I think, even in the world. And they are playing with the destiny of my people. Both of them, sweet sounds, promises, both of them, disgusting policies, both of them calling these terrorists, these dinosaur Taliban brother, and also fascist man like Gulbuddin Hekmatyar. Anyway, they millions of dollars they spent, because this 8 years at least they looted millions of dollars, and still, you know, $250 million they spent for the election. And now they are going for the second period of the election, spend more money, waste more money. That's why day by day we believe that American government, NATO, they just waste their taxpayer money and blood of their soldiers by supporting such a mafia corrupt system in Afghanistan. And do not be misunderstanding between the people, between the nation and government. Same like my country, that we have democratic people, we had a proudful history, we have good people in my country, this innocent people of my country who are against war, they believe in democracy, in peace, stability. There are differences with their government, these fascist people who are in power, photocopy of Taliban and also these Taliban. They are just a bunch of killers. And their name is with full of shame in the history of our country has been recorded, first of all. But in US as well, the government is quite different with the nation, with the people. We are so honored and that we have support of Democrat people, organizations, anti-war movement in US and Canada, in Australia, in England, other countries that I'm traveling as speakers. And I'm saying I'm short of words to express my feeling on behalf of my people for their support and solidarity. But again, I'm saying it's not enough, because still these governments are busy with this tragic drama. And still through mainstream media, they want to betray more the truth. Truth itself is the alternative, I think. When the truth comes out, it will bring, first of all, international solidarity. And this is a positive thing. And also, this 30 years war, we almost lost everything. But we gain one positive thing, which is political knowledge and consciousness of my people improved a lot. Let's support these people. Educationally support. Education is a key toward emancipation. These most of brave women that going outside, they do demonstration, not educated. These men as well. If they get education, they play their role more, and they will never sit silent. As a famous saying, injustice anywhere, the start of justice everywhere. But we need your practical support. First of all, we need your support as a Democrat. Raise your voice as much as you can against the wrong policy of your government. In Kabul, when you go, you see large building, like city center, expensive shop, Serena Hotel. Even Serena Hotel in Kabul has been attacked. That these foreigners, these so-called politicians from outside, coming enjoying their life in so-called politicians of Afghanistan. And these luxury hotels and in some big city they made, this doesn't solve the problem of my people. Today, government of Hamid Karzai has no control outside of Kabul. No journalists there to go outside of Kabul, but they are coming in Kabul, just meet with some these so-called member of parliament, representative of people, while they are not lawmaker, they are lawbroker. We have jungle law in Afghanistan because of these warlords. Some few Democrats inside of parliament, we have men and women that you can count them. But with them, they don't want to meet them. I was there that I was looking that when these politicians coming from outside, high-ranking officials, they choose among us, this one, that one, that go and meet with them, wasting the time, deceiving each other, make up each other, not deceiving. They know very well what they are doing in my country. Then coming here and give report to you people, the name public opinion. Anyway, my people now make ridicule as that Kaza is not even able to be like mayor of Kabul, as has no control. Even in Kabul, most of women are wearing burqa, security, nobody guarantee the security. They say we built some school. It is true. They say we do humanitarian works. In some big cities, it is true that they built some schools. But in most of provinces, again, I'm seeing situations like hell, especially for the woman. Even in these schools right now, this privatization is another enemy of my people. They make some private university schools that they are going, who's going and joining, studying there? These family of these who are in power, these so-called politicians. Most of people cannot go there. Best teachers going there because of good salary. And the university, I have contact with people, the level of education is so low, with many problems, not only in university, in schools, that in faraway provinces, under 10 still they are studying. This is hope. This shows the eager of my people, but they don't want educationally support my people. Some school they build, when they are going to school, they threw acids on their faces. 15 girls in Kandahar, what happened with them? Maybe you hear through media. Tomorrow, how they should dare to send their daughters to the school? Hundreds of girls, media give report in the northern provinces, they become poisoned. Tomorrow, how they should dare to go back to school? And while the government gave reports, hundreds of doors of schools got closed. No, they are not Taliban only. Yeah, they are Taliban that doing crimes, but in the meantime, these warlords as well, it's like fashionable for the media that every crime is happening, they say only Taliban did. Again, I'm saying they are not Taliban. We are between three powerful enemies. Taliban, warlord, who are negotiating with each other, and these occupation forces. With the withdrawal of occupation forces, much easier to fight against one enemy instead of two. They say civil war will happen in Afghanistan if troops leave. But nobody wants to talk about today's civil war. As long as these troops be in Afghanistan, the worst civil war is in Afghanistan. And these troops themselves are the victim of the wrong policy of their government. Send them for war. I met Mathis, maybe you know Mathis Schwitz, this brave young man that last night he was introducing me, and even he couldn't control his tears. He was in Iraq and also Afghanistan. He refused. He said, I don't want to go in Afghanistan, in Iraq. I don't want to be war criminal. Because they are looking at what their government is doing there. And I said condolences to those family who lost their sons in Afghanistan as a troops, but they are the one who first of all raised their voice against the wrong policy of their government that is still they are supporting these criminals in Afghanistan. So I have a lot to say for you to share with you on behalf of my people, but because of lack of time, I'm sure you have questions as well. But let me say at the end, there is some alternative as well. As always, these warlords and these so-called politicians accuse me that he's talking about this disaster, never alternative, which is, while alternative is so easy to understand. First alternative, as soon as possible, occupation must be ended in Afghanistan. Our history showed we never accept occupation. They are killing civilians under the name of Taliban. And also, the second alternative is that stop arming these warlords. Not negotiate with Taliban. Only Mullah Omar and Gulbuddin is not in power. Obama is going to invite them as well to join the government and put moderate name on them, while we have no moderate Talib. These are terrorist Talib terrible makers. They put soft name on Taliban to deceive you people around the world that moderate Talib coming to give chance more to Taliban. While Taliban already they are in power. Later I should give you their names. The third alternative is these democratic-minded, some forces we have, intellectuals, they are the ones who must be supported for the future of Afghanistan. People trust them. They are the ones who able terrorism and fundamentalism, but there is no honor job for them. If they stand up against them, their destiny will be like me. My life story is enough to know about the wrong policy of the U.S. government and its allies in Afghanistan, which is just mockery of democracy and mockery of war on terror. As an activist in the period of Taliban, with burqa underground, I was activist. It was risky, but now even with burqa and bodyguard is not safe. Many assassination attempts, maybe you hear. Anyway, on behalf of those Democrat innocent people, at least I am in front of you. And we have many in Afghanistan. They're risking their life. Nobody knows them. Let's support them. Let's Obama educationally support my people, if you are honest. Say apologize to my people for the war crime of Bush. Don't surge more troops in Afghanistan. Similar policy of the Bush. And also, the third fourth alternative is stop. Means that together with UN, they must stop neighbor countries like Iran, Pakistan, Russia, Uzbekistan, etc., who support Taliban and also these warlords. They have their own puppets. It's still supporting them, giving them arms and also money. And this disgusting law, Shia law, that they made recently, in the back of this was completely the hand of the Shia fundamentalist. The fascist regime of Iran. That for years they are trying to export their brand of Islam in Afghanistan, this fundamentalist, as they mix Islam with politics as a weapon, use it against my people. That's why they are against secular democrat government. While they are trying, everyone in Afghanistan who talk about secularism, they accuse as a blasphemy. They are saying they are infidel, they are communists, while secularism is not like that. The simple meaning of secularism, the politics will be separate from the government. That no fundamentalists have chance to mix Islam with politics, use it against women especially in my country. That's why nobody there in Afghanistan to talk about secularism. And these are at least few examples I said as an alternative. If they really they are honest for my people. But no, they are betraying more my people as Dan White, I told you, two terrorists is not in power, Mullah Omar and Gulbuddin, to join also the government. So let me conclude today's speech. With the quote of a great Democrat American man like Martin Luther King, who says, unarmed truth and unconditional love will have the final words in reality. This is why right, temporarily defeated, is stronger than evil triumphant. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that amazing talk. I think we've all learned something. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to take this mic around. So whoever has a question, please raise your hand. Okay. Yes, sir.
I would suggest that the level of corruption is extends significantly beyond the frightful things that you have outlined, and that it extends within the Volags and the governmental administrators and bureaucrats that are involved in implementing aid. And this, I think, is a very, very real tragedy, and something that there's no oversight that provides a basis for curing that. Number two, you mentioned that Sabretala Mujaddidi was the chairman of the parliament or of the group that permitted you to make your first speech of self-determination, if I can use that terminology for you. This is a man that I've known for 30 years. And he indeed has his faults, but at least he gave you the first leg up for your self-identification, which I think is good. Number
Could you get to the point of the question, sorry.
You've outlined the how terrible things are. If you were able to have the ear of President Obama, what is your solution to this, other than do this, do that? How do you see a resolution to the current situation?
Thank you. یعنی سخت نباشد سیام که اگه سر اوباما گپ میزنی که اگه اوباما اگه چانس داشتی گپ بزنی چی میخوایی که حل کنم problem of Afghanistan.
در مورد مجاهدی نفهمیدم چطور چانس دادین ببخشید. Yeah, regarding corruption, you said corruption میگه رشوت خوریدنی. Yeah, it depends to the government again. As long as these looters, these killers, these misogynists in power, impossible to stop corruption. As I said, I use this proverb that my people use a lot, that it seems like to make rabbit to have responsible of carrot. So the second part you said regarding Mujahideen, you know, for a person you ask me to forgive, how I should forgive that they destroyed my country, changed to the ruin. Afghanistan was that much beautiful that even people from abroad, they come as a tourist to see Kabul. Kabul, the name they put, beautiful, bright city. They destroyed our national unity. They are puppets. They are misogynists. They killed many women. Still they are killing and raping. They destroyed our historical memorial and so many crimes like this. How I should forgive them as a person, I'm telling, not on behalf of. And give me chance, you know how much it was difficult that I got chance? They didn't want to give me chance to have a speech in Lojirga 2003. Different ways and tactics I used that finally I got this microphone. Some Democrat was there, they told me, Malalai, let's we do demonstration because they are not going to give us chance to talk. I said, no. This tribune is the best one. Let's use that because international attention. I think this is my idea. And they were agree, but they didn't give this chance. And would you read in this book that how was difficult I found chance to speak for, you know what I said? I said on behalf of young generation. They said, oh, this little girl, what she will say, let's allow her. And it sounds sweetie for them. I don't know, something khush on Ahmed. It sounds something like, let's see what she will say for 2 minutes. Cute. Yeah, something like that. And I'm glad and I never regret that I used from this tribune for the benefit of my people and I teared their mask. And you see that they couldn't tolerate. They gave me 3 minutes special, but less than 2 minutes they couldn't tolerate. They turned off microphone and threatened to date and beat it, etc. Even which was so sad, these fundamentalist women who they did campaign for them, they were trying to beat me as well. And same like in parliament, one fundamentalist woman did like this. If you do not sit silence, I will do something against you that no man dared to do. Just I said, you are a victim. So not only me as a person, never will forgive them. Forgive Bakhshidan. The history of my country first never forgive in my people. See, they are like Pinochet. They are like Mussolini. They are like Franco. They are like terrorists of other countries. Their blood is red in them. That they are coming in power without to be bring to the court, without at least say apologize to my people. You know, they want to put soft name on Taliban. These terrorists also they want to bring in power. While we have many Taliban power. Today one member of parliament is Talib, Mullah Abdul Salam Rakati, who raped 3 Chinese women when was commander of Sayof and then become commander of Taliban, now enjoying in parliament, and which is so ridiculous as running for the election, the so-called free election. If really Obama honest, why he is saying, I don't support any candidate in Afghanistan. No, we cannot trust you. Say that this is a legal act. Why Taliban even running and these wanted criminal? This 8 years is enough to know about the war crime, wrong policy of the Bush. Say that we raise the voice against that. Why didn't raise? Why other NATO, they are silenced, the NATO country government that who have troops in Afghanistan. Anyway, they are not honest for my people. They want to make their military base in Afghanistan by supporting this bunch of puppets. Invested lots of money, millions of dollars since Cold War, and still supporting them. And also, no Afghan will be their puppet anymore. And with Obama, if I say, if I meet, of course, my first point that I will tell him, please stop this war on innocent civilians. Stop occupation. No nation can donate liberation to another nation. My people can liberate themselves. If a little bit, they let us Britain peace. That's our problem. If they support Democrat, I will give him some address. Support them. Why do not support? Why you are bringing Mullah Omar? In 9 months, what Gulbuddin Hekmatyar did that push put price on the head of him? $25 million as a terrorist? But you invite Mullah Omar to come in power. Even you are doing worse than Bush.
Thank you. You mentioned there's a historic condition of women and abuse and violence that goes beyond the warlord and the Taliban. Can you talk to me how this is going to be addressed long term and around beyond Sharia law, but the condition of women in general and the abuses against them?
Yeah. It take long time, you know that, as I said, my country look like a sick cow, sick body, to say better. They even want to have their own peace. They, we have many Democrat women and activist women, brave women, same like we had in the history of Afghanistan, heroine like Malalai of Maivan, Nahid, Wajji, Amina, that they inspire us, and also Democrat men. But there in Afghanistan, no honor job for them, do not support them. To fight against occupation at least take 10 years, 15 years, that to fight against them with empty hands. In the same time, people are very tired from the war. They hate these warlords and these terrorists, Taliban, getting powerful. So it takes time. When the main alternative that to support democratic-minded, main hope, that they must not leave us alone. A little bit if you support us, educationally, for example, for you, maybe it means very little, but they are bringing very positive changes and gives, first of all, hopes. Raise your voice against the wrong policy of your government. Tell the truth. And these things will bring, means that these warlords, when get stop arming, that do not support, and also these Taliban, then slowly, slowly, women rights itself is coming in Afghanistan. But, yeah, and also, yeah, you are right, this economical problem, also another problem. But all of these problem, economical problem, this corruption to be stopped, that violence is against women, and also all of these crimes, education improve. Again, main key is the government. When the government will be non-democratic government and also corrupt government, mafia government, how it is possible that trust and be hopeful at least that women rights will come in Afghanistan? No, I never say that never coming, but it takes time, as I told you. People like mushroom, they themselves stand up. But these mushrooms, they need leadership. These men and women who are coming out on the streets, they do demonstration, they need leaders. Who is their leaders? These Democrats. While we have many in Afghanistan, intellectuals and some party. Let's support them while they are losing even their projects. And for the passage of time, they face more with the resistance of my people. If voluntarily they do not leave Afghanistan, the situation of women will get better. Same in the past, we had women with open hair, with as they wished, they were closed, they enjoyed their life in centuries of 60s, 70s. I have some clip film that right now not possible, that it's not with me, that showed you in some conference I show, that it shows how step by step women are the most victim. But you know why? Because woman is a big power. One wing of the bird. When one wing of the bird in society to be injured, how the bird can fly? When do not have education, self-immolation, why getting increased? Why we are risking the life, we Democrat? Because to give a little hope to, first of all, to these victim families. Some clips you can see on my website. They say the government, when do not listen our voice, we kill ourselves. I say, no, this is not the solution. Raise your voice against, go back to the school. You are the one who should take your revenge. Woman rights is not a beautiful flower someone gift us. Also, some men, one man told me, Malalai, if the government do not take their revenge, I will go with Taliban to take my revenge from the warlord. I said, no. To go with one terrorist to fight against another terrorist, this is not the solution. And to bring justice in Afghanistan. Anyway, we that's why we risk our lives, and we are trying that in the meantime to serve our people. And one day, these are the nation that can bring these criminals to the court.
Can I just say something? Can I just say something in terms of just the questions? Just taking advantage of being a moderator here.
Please. The question of just because of my own, I guess, economic background, and I teach in that field, so. Relation to women's rights and also corruption. You know, a lot of light is put into Afghan corruption, but how about foreign corruption? I mean, 90% of the money that we get that supposedly comes to Afghanistan goes to NGOs. So why don't you point that out? you know. Yeah, yeah, that's important because, you know, that's yeah. that's the corruption that you need to take care of, not Afghan corruption, okay? That's one. In terms of women's rights, you know, I mean, if you just look at Western history, any other country history, you can't really have any rights of, you know, whether women, men, until you have some form of economic development, where opportunities, urbanization, growth developed. I mean, you could have rights on paper, but it can't be implemented where women themselves cannot become economically independent. And you don't do that when you have a government that's corrupt, when 90% of the money doesn't go to the government, it goes to NGOs who are like lotuses there. So, we have to look at, again, you know, just if you just take in terms of the last 10 years or 8 years that the U.S. has been there, I mean, these are just facts, not poetry. 90% of the money goes to NGOs. The government first of all, you have to, you know, as Malalai is saying, that there's corrupt people in the government. Incompetent people. But then even those incompetent people don't even get enough money, sufficient money to create some form of capacity. Now, when you have the crisis in America, where are banks running to? Aren't they running to the government? I mean, you have some form of capacity here where the government can take care of the economic crisis. You know, the market itself needs some form of ushering or guidance. You don't have any capacity building in Afghanistan. The agricultural department, 80% of Afghans reside in the rural areas. How come America hasn't developed the rural areas? How come there hasn't sustained development? I mean, just, you know, it's very lukewarm development, you see. So you have to, you know, look at how these things affect the oppression of women and men also oppress there. But, you know, so, you know, the West, 40 countries, with America, and they can't take care of opium? Just, you know, you think about that yourself.
Yeah. Only one point before the another question. Let me one point. I say that report of New York Times on 8th of November, 1959. This is the New York Times report. Says Afghanistan woman left the veil of new world of freedom, spiritual as well as sartorial, has been opened to the woman of this Muslim nation after centuries of seclusion. Only this report is enough to show the big lie of the U.S. government, that first time we brought women rights. They say women do not wear burqa, while this disgusting burqa now gives lives, which is like shroud for life bodies, symbol of oppression. I think you all agree with us. But most of women are wearing burqa, and again I say that problem, as I told you, they misuse Islam. Problem of my people is not with Islam at all. Their problem is with Islam of Osama bin Laden, Mullah Omar, Gulbuddin, Sayyaf, Dostum, Mohakik, Ismail Khan, these so-called Democrats with suit and tie that who are in power, and Islam is a good weapon in their hands and use it against my people, especially women.
Hi, my name is Sunitha Vishwanathan. I'm really sorry that I missed most of your presentation. I have family members sick, but I came and I'm so glad that I'm here. Thank you for giving me the microphone. I'm the founder and board member of an organization called Women for Afghan Women. We, members of our organization, know you, Malalai, and you're a heroine for us. And I often, we're a community-based organization, both here, and we have a community center here in Flushing, Queens. And for the last 4 years, we've been active, very active, on the ground in Afghanistan. And often, I personally talk about you, Malalai, when I hear women talking about how there's no contradiction between Islam and feminism, I find myself saying, remembering that moment in 2003 when you stood up and you said that the people who are here in this room don't deserve to be here, you need to be tried in a court, and then what was thrown at you was your voice is equal to half the voice of a man. Mm-hmm. I want Islamic feminism to speak to that. I mean, I haven't heard the response yet. Oh. And so in so many ways, you're an icon for us, and Esther in our organization knows you and sends regards. So that being said, this process of debate around U.S. in Afghanistan, the U.S. troops, whether they should stay, whether they should leave, whether we need more troops, has been agonizing for us. And we have spent since January in our organization. I should say that we have 100 staff in Afghanistan. We have a staff of 4 in Queens. We're a board of 5. All of us have engaged in internal dialogue to to come to some kind of consensus on, you know, what do we think about the U.S. role in Afghanistan? We're near consensus. All of us but one, has reached a statement. And I'm carrying the statement if anyone is interested in seeing it. And it's on our website, womenforafghanwomen.org. And it's the first time we are at odds with you, Malalai, and it's not a happy position that we're in. We don't want to be at odds with you. We're not advocates of war. But in the 4 years that we've been doing work on the ground in Afghanistan, we run women's centers and secret women's shelters, and in 4 years, something like 1,500 women and some men have come through our centers, always people who have experienced human rights violations. So we feel we have a legitimate voice. And the work that we do is becoming increasingly difficult because the Taliban, unlike what you would read in the New York Times, isn't just in the South, it's really spreading its tentacles. And we can't, for instance, in Logar, which is, where is Logar?
Logar is south of Kabul.
South of Kabul. That's there, we have built a girls' school, which is now functional, and we were raising money for it, and fundraising was going quite well, and now we have to build a wall around the school, and the funders who we're in touch with suddenly feel it's dangerous to fund us for that wall. Of course, we will build the wall. We'll raise the money somehow. But the funders are feeling that it's too dangerous to go and check out the situation and go and check on the school and their what their funding is achieving. It's too dangerous for them to come.
Okay.
So we don't have a wall. But in the meanwhile, in this place where the Taliban has gained strength, there are these little girls going to school.
So essentially, you're saying that if Malalai arguing for the occupation to leave, you would say that you wouldn't be able to do this work. So let me just tell her that. میگه که اگه امریکا مثلا بره وزی کارهایی که میکنن و دیگه سازمانهایی که میکنن نمیتونن کنن. یعنی شما چی فکر میکنه از این نگاه؟
Can I finish? Just if I finish, then you can. I'm sure that you'll have a lot to say.
I think if you didn't finish.
No, I just want to finish my point. It's
okay.
Sorry, and then I'll leave it. And as I say, we have been talking about this internally since January. This has been absolutely agonizing. Mm-hmm. We agree that the U.S. presence in Afghanistan has not been effective. We agree about the corruption, and we agree that not enough. I mean, they're saying that in 2020, the Millennium Development Goals are adjusted for Afghanistan because we're so behind the rest of the world. So the rest of the world, 2015 is the goal for Afghanistan. Primary school children will be in school by 2020. I agree. Why has the U.S. and other international countries not poured money into development? And all of us in WA, except one person, say if the U.S. withdraws, if international troops withdraw, what will happen to the people who live there? What will happen to the women? We will be handing the country over to the Taliban, and we will go back to those dark days before 2001. It's just not an option.
Okay, so let her answer.
Yeah, I was glad if you listened my speech. I think if you listened, all the questions was already answered. But let me say again that first, thanks for your support for Afghan people, especially women. Hopefully to have more project. As always, this is my main message. Especially educational support for my people, especially women, is very important. Today when journalist was asking me also the same question you asked on behalf of your organization, that asked me, do you know this organization? I said, to be honest, I don't know very well about them because I'm not in contact with them and like some other organizations who have activities in Afghanistan. But regarding this point that they said they are not agree with the withdrawal of the troops. But I think now, if you were instead of us regarding this bombing, that killing innocent civilians and this occupation, that is now so clear for my people. You know, British high-ranking official says we need to be in Afghanistan for 40 years to fight against so-called war on terror, which is quite example of occupation. Now, in Bagram City, maybe you also hear through some news that they are going to spend $80 million to make another Guantanamo jail there. They banned the supply of water. This 8 years, they changed Afghanistan to the capital of drug. The situation of the woman is like hell in most of provinces. 5-year-old baby, 14-year-old baby. Mothers, they are getting raped throwing acid on their faces, kidnapping them, many violences, as during my speech I said. An economic problem. And let me tell you a few examples as a gift of the US government. You know, when then you should compare their positive role in Afghanistan, these troops, their government, and negative. Of course, it's very less. As I told you, some activities they did in some schools they built in some big cities, while even in these cities they do not dare to go because of security to the schools. How much education is important? They allow some organization like your organization to have some project there. But how about around Afghanistan we are talking in total? Not only few provinces, that some project you have, millions of people that how much they need more support. While government gave report $36 billion is not less, my sister, they received. If this money was spent, no need that to be more organization in Afghanistan like your organizations that to have some project. You should also have, it will improve the well. No need to be any troops in Afghanistan. This positive. And this is not only I'm saying. This is many report here. Now I was searching in one of my article I wrote for some newspapers every day. Many article they are asking to write about us. Now it become open secret for the people around the world, this occupation. Not only for my people, that what they gave report about. For example, FAO report, as I said, 18 million people of Afghanistan live on less $2 a day. 80% people of Afghanistan live below the poverty line. Regarding report of USAID, USAID, that they says, let me say exactly, about 42% of the country's estimated 27 million people live on less than $1 a day, according to the U.S. Agency for International Development. And regarding UNICEF report, the UN Children's Fund means this UNICEF estimates that up to 50,000 children die from
diarrheal
disease every year. In many report like this, anyway, I think you also heard about. As I said, now it is open secret. UN gave report: 93% opium produced from Afghanistan. New York Times wrote: brother of Hamid Karzai is a famous drug trafficker. In many example, at least this point is enough. Obama wants to bring Mullah Omar, this terrorist, also to join the government under the name of moderate, while we have no moderate. So this occupation will leave Afghanistan, that they are not honest. Yeah, they have some project and some organization they have, like your organization, activities, but that we say do more. We wish that they were honest, that this money directly is spent for the people. But no, most of these money is going into pocket of NGO lords, warlords, drug lords, these killers. So these occupation, they are not honest. They leave, then easier to fight against one enemy instead of two. You know, but to fight against these enemy, let me finish that point. To fight against this enemy is not easy. They are dinosaur. They are wolf. As I told you, they are in the skin of lamb. When they were mice, Taliban come in power, skipping their host, these warlords. After 9/11, they back become wolf. Now they are just in the skin of lambs, deceiving people around the world. As much as more support get these wolves, more risky for the future of Afghanistan. And they are supporting, they are sending more money for such a mafia government, and also sending more troops in Afghanistan. So they, as soon as possible, must leave. But they say civil war happened. I said earlier that today itself is like civil war. What's going on, all of these? They cut the nose and ears of the woman through hot waters in this violent way, and then face to the court, nobody listened their voice because there is no justice. They cut into peace two women in Mazar-e-Sharif. And this is their gift, you know, for my people. They threw acids on the face of the girls, and all of these civil war violences. But those who did civil war, they supporting these responsible of the civil war. No civil war will happen, yeah. People defeat themselves, people stand up themselves. With the passage of time, they face with the resistance of people, political knowledge people improve, they do not be deceived. But I told you, we need helping hand of democrat people, not occupation. Yeah, I said that we don't need that to be any organization. Two times Afghanistan was rebuilt. You know, this is democracy. We can be agree about some point, But one point that we all agree, I think, as a human being, we are against occupation. The history shows, not history of my country. We give good lesson to British in the past, British government. We give good lesson to a superpower country like U.S. And we will give good lesson to the U.S. government and allies if do not stop this war crime.
Sure. Back here. Malalai, I apologize. I was working on some of her media stuff when she asked about the UN report, but I looked it up. The UN Development Project, only Niger, a very poor, underdeveloped country in Africa, has a lower human development index. And only 5 countries in the world have a lower life expectancy than Afghanistan. The latest show, 43.6 years is the life expectancy in Afghanistan. So I just had a couple of quick comments, if not really question, because I worked pretty closely with Malalai. It's been a great honor the last couple of years to be able to do that. I guess the first comment is just, I'm based in Canada, and Canadian troops are there, 2,000 or 3,000, and they're in Kandahar province, which was the birthplace in 94 of the Taliban, which it's important to remember that Hamid Karzai was a Pashtun minor tribal leader. He supported the Taliban. He was a Taliban supporter for the first 2 years of their rule before he decided his long-term prospects were better. You got some advice from his contacts with the CIA and so forth. This is all on the historical record, but it's worth keeping in mind. But anyway, in Kandahar, not to make the point too long, it's Hamid Karzai's brother who is the main drug kingpin and the most powerful person in Afghanistan. So if you say, well, if we leave, Taliban or some other bad people are going to take control or fight over the country, you're also saying, if we stay, we're killing civilians and we're having our soldiers from these countries die to defend drug kingpins like Karzai's brother. And how can you be surprised that Afghans are turning against a government when there's this level of nepotism and corruption and drug trafficking just out in the open? And I guess just the other comment I wanted to make is that founders of humanitarian organizations and people who in the past backed military intervention for humanitarian goals have become more critical. David Rieff was one person who wrote a book criticizing humanitarian organizations who tie themselves entirely to state violence and imperial violence, and just pointing out that while the impulse to help is good and positive, you can't tie that impulse to help and do good in faraway countries entirely to a military and an imperial process. In Afghanistan, it's not just about the war in Afghanistan, it's about a whole military project for the United States to maintain its dominance in the world. For instance, Bagram Air Base, when they close Guantanamo, many of those people who are held in an illegal fashion are going to be transferred to Bagram Air Base. So if you're opposed to the US troops leaving Afghanistan, then you're supporting the continuation of torture, illegal rendition, and indefinite detention at Bagram Air Base. So I don't want to give too much of a speech, but just a couple things that all of this is dealt with by Malalai in the book, but brought to mind by the discussion.
You know, $100 million U.S. government used for war every day in Afghanistan, while total reconstruction for Afghanistan every day is $1 million. As I said, most of these money has been looted. It is good that you have some project. You know, they want to make you happy with this, but please compare your project about all around Afghanistan. Is this enough or not? As I said earlier, if the occupation forces they didn't occupy my country today, no need to be many foreign NGO, this corrupt NGOs and Afghan NGO. I do not be misunderstand. Most of them, no. Most of them, yes, they are corrupt, but less few of them. I admire your project you have, but if the troops, this country do not occupy my country, you had more project, more support. If this money went for a good cause that they spent for war, impossible to bring democracy, peace by war, then no need to be any troops in Afghanistan. 2 times I said Afghanistan rebel. Ahmed Karzai himself, few days before, said to the BBC, you know, said in the 3 provinces of Afghanistan, Baghlan, Samangan, Kunduz, during the night they are bringing all men by unknown helicopters. People know very well that who bringing these terrorists there to make they are also insecure. Then through mainstream media tell to you people, It's got to send more troops than Afghanistan, Taliban getting powerful. Who is Taliban, these medieval-minded terrorists? U.S. government created them, and U.S. government destroyed their domination. On that time, how much was powerful on 9/11 that they did this terrorist activity? But now this 8 years is not possible. A superpower country with 14 more countries with high modern machine, the military machine in their hands is powerful, or medieval-minded, ignorant terrorist people like Taliban. See, here is this report. Taliban, these non-educated, medieval-minded, ignorant people, they almost destroyed opium. See, this is 94 report, this is 99, and this is 2001. Almost they destroyed. But now this is the 2007, while it is more than that, 4,500% it increased. Your project is good, but how about this risky opium? You know, that's why you should, only opium is enough to know about the occupation of Afghanistan. And millions of dollars, yeah, they received. Many other figures that they addict to, and because opium is for them, it's an addiction. All of these. As I said, it will destroy the life of youths here in these countries as well if they do not stop. Because they do dirty business with opium. They occupied Iraq because of Isle of Iraq. They occupied Afghanistan, geopolitical location of Afghanistan. If Afghanistan to be their military base and also under control of them, very easily they can control China, going to be superpower, they don't want, U.S. don't want, U.S. government, Russia, Iran, Pakistan, etc., who they also have their puppets in Afghanistan. So they can easily control them and have very easily access to the oil and gas of the Central Asian republics. And also this center of opium that they change millions of dollars are receiving. Busy still with this dirty business.
I just have a question. I don't think we're going to, dialogue is really important and we need each other. So dialogue to a place where we're seeing eye to eye and we're allies. There's no question about that. But, and we don't disagree with what you say. And the only question I have for you is what is going to happen? Say the U.S. pulls out and the other international countries. No, just tell what I mean. We see very dark days for Afghanistan if all the international troops pull out, and that's where we're coming from. We won't be able to. Today, RED is traveling with her little newborn baby to Mazar to be active in our center and our shelter there. She's a kind, giving person. Where, I don't know where that person. So we have the impulse
you
to.
Can be, you can right. Disagree, so. But what I want to tell no. I want to tell you with the passage of time, you will know how much we are right. As today, it became open secret for the people around the world. What will happen? I told you, Taliban already, they got powerful. These warlords, they are in power and now negotiating with Taliban. So as long as these troops to be in Afghanistan, these terrorists, these dinosaurs getting more powerful. Because their government giving more money, more weapon, more power to these such terrorists. They do not support Democrats in my country. That's why we say one enemy get less, much easier to fight against one than two. But how to fight? Yeah. But with the resistance of the people, day by day getting increased. Educationally support my people, as I told you, it's a main key for the emancipation of my country. International solidarity is the key. Telling the truth, raise your voice. Today, the world is very small because of internet, like a village. Push pressure on your government. At least gives hopes, courage to others. But it never make any sense that if troops leave, civil war will happen. So set silence. See the occupation. This more enemy, one more enemy. This is not the alternative.
Thank you very much. My name is Dr. Nadi. I'm a dentist. Lived in the United States for at least 27 years. And also helped found the Afghanistan Peace Association, and I'm a member of it. I'm not an American citizen, and that is a protest because I know that for at least the past 30, 35 years, the way Americans fought in Afghanistan, or the West in general, the progressive and democratic-minded people, and put them out of power, and then finally brought the jihadi thugs into power and then made them fight each other and then destroy Afghanistan and now and then Taliban and then Taliban put out of power and now Karzai and Abdullah We know that Karzai is, as this gentleman described, where he come from, and I know Abdullah Abdullah from the book of Steve Cole, that his mentor or teacher of English was MI6 of England or Britain. So obviously he is an intelligence agent from Britain. My question to you is, why do you think there is a war between the Western countries as to who should be the president of Afghanistan between Karzai and Abdullah Abdullah? Yeah. If you could shed some light on that, I would really appreciate that. Thank you. Let me ask this in Farsi too. I'm sorry, because most of the audience is English speaking, of course.
Sorry, just to be sure, that's why do not be misunderstanding. Because of lack of time, I prefer to be translator as well.
Yes. I translated myself. Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Nama Dr. Nuhadi, McDentist system, the New York Takriban Mr. Hafsal as the Negimekonom, Citizen Americanistum, Green Court Dorum. What the Lil Sham Hami as the Kema Mutawajim as Ami Bista Hafsal, Kem Rikawa, the Majmo Garb, Khostan Kedar Afghanistan, Korhai Bokonan, Kilafiman of him, Mili Afghanistan Buddha. مردمای دموکراتیک مایند و طرفدار دموکراسی را میشه کوشش کنند مارجینالایز کنند گوشه بزنند و بالاخره جهادیای جنگی را یا جنگ سالارای جهادی را آوردن و باز طالبان را و اونا را هم از بین بردن و بالاخره کرزای عبدالله عبدالله را آوردن. سوال ما شما این است که اگر میتونید کمک روشنی بندازین که چرا غربی ها بالای آوردن کرزی و دکتر عبدالله جنگ دارن و می خواهیم که کدامش رئیس جمهور افغانستان باشه، در حالی که ما می فهمیم کرزی از CIA آمد و یقیناً بر اساس کتاب استیف کول called The Ghost of War, what's that? Ghost Wars, page 123, I never forget this page number, I read that he was taught English by Britons, I'm sorry, که این زبان انگلیسی را توسط استخبارات انگلیس درس داده شده. و من میخوام بفهم که چرا اینا می جنگن که کی رئیس جمهور افغانستان باشه در حالی که هر دوشان مربوط به خودشان است. تشکر.
Yeah, first, thanks for your support. Let me say that, now fighting because of power, as I said during my speech, between two puppets, who both of them betrayed a lot my people, still they are betraying. Now, it is true that, as I said, now, with very beautiful clothes, with suit and tie, doing shave, talking very beautiful about democracy, women rights, human rights, but they don't believe. And these warlords also become divided to two parts, as I said. But the main point that why they support this too is they are expert puppets. You know, like many other that we have, they are a bunch of killers. First of all, they are puppets since Cold War. They invested millions of dollars on them. But on that time, we fought it against the occupation. Nobody knew them because the important key was that all must be against occupation. They didn't want to see this party, another party. Who is they? Everyone who fight against the occupation, people admired because this was the main point for them, important for them. All together fight it, and they got money and also from the U.S. government and etc. But after when Russia fell, they showed their real nature to the people of my country, first of all, to the real Mujahideen, these criminal Mujahideen. As we always divide Mujahideen, the freedom-loving fighters, with a bunch of these puppets. And everyone first destroyed national unity, and they, because of power, and they killed people, even raped 20-year-old mother, etc. You can see Human Rights Watch website, Amnesty International website, like the book you mentioned, Ghost War, Eyes for Infidel book, Bleeding Afghanistan book. Today, world know them, but they imposed on my people. It's still supporting them. After 9/11, they know very well who are these warlords who did civil war, but they brought them in power. People, in the beginning, they understood that they are not honest for our people. Let's see again which kind of game they are playing with the destiny of my people. That's why they changed Afghanistan once again to their playground and supported them, and still don't want to lose them. And now, this Abdullah, they are trying to decorate Abdullah as someone that who have fought among my people. You know, he's bringing from different provinces the people with lots of money spending, and then make Falem show to you people around the world, see he has food among the people, while millions of people didn't attend in the election. Less than 10% people attend. Millions of money they spend. How they got this money? when he was in power minister, and also from Russia he is receiving this Abdullah money, is still receiving from the Dirty of Opium, receiving from Iran fundamentalist regime, receiving from CIA, receiving their expert puppet. Anyway, we have many Democrats, as you said, who will be president of Afghanistan. This is not the question, my brother. We have many Democrats in Afghanistan. Same like other country, I said, only we have bunch of color. This Dr. Ramazan Bashardos, you know, he was Minister of Planning. He did survey. He said most of NGO corrupt. Afghan in foreign. Yeah. People that much love him that he become famous after that, because Karzai want to close the door of these corrupt NGOs. Karzai didn't agree. He resigned from the post. He loved his people more than the chair. And that's why he ran for the presidential election, for parliamentary election. They allowed him, same like they allowed me, free Democrat in the parliament, to deceive you people. See, there is democracy. Someone like Bashar Dost who criticized the government, someone like Joya exposed the crime of these warlords. They are there, but never talk that even they threatened me to rape inside of the parliament. They beat it. They treat to with knife. And finally, they expelled. And this is the situation for other Democrats. And at least, as I said, my life story, and this Bashar Dost I was telling you. Bashar Dost ran for the election. I told to Bashar Dost, Dr. Ramazan Bashar Dost, with all of my body, I support you, but I know you do not win. I said congratulations, in the meantime, condolence. You know why? Because I said you are not puppet. In some part, this is democracy. I'm not agree with Dr. Bashar Dost, but this is democracy, at least for me, which is important. He do not have bloody hand. And anyway, he didn't win. As a famous saying, I told you, it's not important who is voting, it's important who is counting. Despite all of these corruptions, I think he won the third winner, isn't it? The third winner. Anyway, there is no chance for Democrat in our country for presidential election. One chance for a puppet, but for parliamentary election and provincial election, we have some chance for Democrats. Please tell to them to be candidate. If win, to be the small voice of the people in these national houses.
Thank you, Ms. Joya, for being here. I just wanted to ask you, despite all these animosities against you, what keeps you going and what inspires you, and what kind of message do you have to young women around the world that are also perhaps finding the same struggles as you are, and how would you tell them to empower themselves?
Yeah, always I say my message, let's start from the message. I say to Democrat people around the world, the silence of good people is worse than the action of bad people. Always sometimes journalists asking me, Malalai, which point makes you more worried? I said that, the dirty business with politics. That's the point. And as I said that, I don't fear death. We fear from political silence against the injustice. That's why raise your voice. That's the main message first. And with more details, I said in this book, as some I said, support Democrat-minded people, some alternative. These are the main key. Educationally support. Again, I'm saying this is the key to our emancipation. Support these off of population, this big power woman in Afghanistan that we have, and these Democrat activists, encourage them. I introduced for you some, now a group that they made a kind of, their organization trying to bring justice. They are risking their lives. They are knocking the door of the every Afghan. They are collecting document of the crimes. Because when you go as a journalist, you are asking, could you say about the crimes of them or expose? They are afraid. Who guarantee their life? But when they are without camera like this, they are recording the voice and they are making documents of their crimes, and they are giving photos and documents, etc. So who guarantee the life of these activists? Let's support them, give them more courage, educationally, practical, financially support them. The name, if you want, I can give you by email, and also some other organization like Solidarity Party, Solidarity Organization. Solidarity Voice, I think the exact name I can give you and by email also. Raw organization, that's the only political woman organization that is still they have project, they underground activists. I met Zoya on behalf of them in a conference in US in 2004. Even Slarva invited us, maybe you know about Vide, and she was a speaker, and they are risking their life. This only the film that they made about Zarmina, this girl who has been killed in a stadium of Kabul. If Taliban know, 100% killed that activist of Rawa. And let's support these Democrats. Also, they have a powerful website. It's good for to know about disaster in Afghanistan. Support Haka is a Democrat NGO. Support OPAC, Organization of Promoting Afghan Women Capabilities. That I was activist of that. But now I cannot work because of risk. Even because of me, they lost their project. So some other I know, I give their names. Please support them. And this is the message. Regarding what gives me hope and courage. Yeah, it has many reasons, but let me tell you briefly. First, this truth itself is a big power to give big hope. It's like sun always, I say. No superpower even able to hide the sun. When they will find its deserved place, especially in war countries, that they take time. The history of our country is enough to give us hope. We had proudful history, as I said. We follow the path of hero and heroine of our country and many in the world. That who risk their life for democracy, for women's rights, is still risking, some of them not alive, as I quoted Martin Luther King at least. And also that the strong support of these poor, innocent people of my country, day by day, make me understand this way that I choose is the right way, the best one. Let's we continue this struggle for justice against injustice and these enemies of these values, democracy. Then it is one day we will win. As Brecht is saying, those who struggle may fail, but those who do not do struggle has already failed. You, young generation of Afghanistan, is a big hope. You are victim generation. Raise your voice, especially you are in these countries. Educationally, you are high educated. Support your Afghan sisters, your Afghan brothers here, and you are a big hope. And many hope, support of Democrat people around the world. The rewards that they are giving, put extra responsibilities. These are hopes. Anyway, but one day if something happened to me, I said I'm a person. If today I'm alive because of support of our people, but always I said, I'm honored this is a small voice of my people now become, but if one day they call this voice, they never make silences because this is their voice.
Thanks very much for your talk. I knew many of the things you said in small details, but it was good to have it brought together in a very strong picture of the role of the U.S. and others' occupation. I guess I'm wondering, I mean, I would like to think the U.S. would pull out tomorrow, but I don't think that's going to happen.
They don't want to pull out.
No, I don't think they do. I imagine that at some point they will lose the same way that they lost in Vietnam, and I look forward to that day when they have to pull out. I'm wondering, are there, I didn't quite understand everything in that conversation, but I was wondering, are there democratic organizations that are providing leadership for the people who are resisting right now? And fighting for freedom.
Maybe my English is not good, or I'm talking very fast, because so many times, and sometimes it's a big problem for me always that I'm talking fast. Sorry, I apologize.
No, I didn't mean that. I just mean I'd like to, if
totally
you wouldn't mind repeating some of the organizations.
Yeah, I said, that's why I said maybe I'm talking fast. Yeah, some of these organizations I explained that, these few of them, the name I give. But keep, do not forget my sister, more than party, Democrat parties, we have intellectuals a lot, individuals. They are who I was. I didn't belong to any party. I was just a social activist, but belonged to political situation, political country. Even children of Afghanistan do politics, same like Palestine, as always I'm saying. Even the cats and stones of my country can do politics if it could speak. Even they laughed on this ridiculous election, so-called free election. Anyway, but we have, again, I'm saying the name if you want, by email I can give, like Solidarity Party in Afghanistan. Let me see the exact name of this party. Ambastagi Ragiz and Parshan. Solidarity Party. Freedom Loving Fighters Party, the name. Rawa Organization Party. Some NGO we have, we cannot say they are only activists, you know. They belong to political situation. Let's support these NGOs as well, like Haka, like OPAC. At least I know them and I can trust. And some other, this justice organization, they made the name exactly now. I don't know. Sorry that this is new. But I can give you their email and their website. I have email address I'm giving you. Let's to be in contact and support them. Yeah, and this book also you can read, yeah. With more details, because of lack of time, I'm sorry that cannot say more.
Can I see that book? I'll just wrap up. Okay, thank you everyone for coming out on this day. It's very important that we heard Malalai Joya's voice and inspiration. The book is called A Woman Among Warlords, the Extraordinary Story of an Afghan Who Dared to Raise Her Voice, and it is by Scribner. So please buy the book, support the cause, teach the books if you're teachers, pass it on to your friends. I want to thank Ari, the Asian American Asian Research Institute, for hosting this, and Malalai Joya, thank you so much for joining us, and thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for your help, thanks for your translation, and forgive me for my poor English. And also talking fast, but let me conclude our event with this famous saying that says, the arc of history is long, but it bends toward justice. We wish this day. Thank you.